So here, despite the difficulties of deterministic descriptions of turbulence, that means we cannot accurately, deterministically, it means that we cannot be 100% sure of our description of turbulence, scientists have been able to create a statistical description of turbulence. So how did you do that? Through this Taylor's hypothesis. The goal of this approach is to describe the net effect of many eddies rather than the exact behavior of individual eddy. It means the combination of all these eddies instead of just one particular eddy, because you cannot do that. Because it's too chaotic or too random for us to describe. So this is a simultaneous time series of temperature at four heights above the ground. This is interesting because you see the turbulence are the characteristic of turbulence is different depending on the height from the ground. So if it's close to the ground, you notice that there's a lot more variations. Somewhere above, it's less variation. 4 meters above, 16 meters above. Does that follow what we studied before in the mean layer characteristics, the boundary layer characteristics? Somewhere on the ground, there's a lot more variation because of the sheer effects of turbulence on the ground. Somewhere above is less variation, right? It also can be seen in this temperature sensor. I mean, just imagine if you have a temperature sensor at the close to the ground, it'll be measuring more turbulence, more eddies because of the frictions and so on. There's more eddies there. Above, there's bigger size eddies, so there's less variation, and then somewhere above, even less. And you can see that here. You can try it yourself if you have multiple thermometers at different heights. Suppose that the velocity components U, V, W are sampled at regular time intervals delta T, like say 1 second. Every 1 second you measure U, V, W, and then we digitize and record it on a computer to form a time series UI, VI, WI, where I is the index of the data point corresponding to time T. That means for every second. For 1 into N, it means for your the length of the measurement in a time series. So the U component of the mean wind U based on an average over time period is thus this one. So something like temperature, but now it's for velocity. So far you've only referred to wind as just one magnitude, one U value, mean wind speed, right? But you know, wind, is it a scalar quantity or is it a vector quantity? Wind is just a vector. So imagine that this is a three-dimensional space where this is U, this is V, and this is W. So this wind has a certain magnitude, let's say 1 meter per second, at a certain angle. So this U bar, or mean wind, the ones that you see in weather underground, all that, the minimum wind speed, the maximum wind speed that you use in air quality modeling, is this mean wind. But this mean wind can be broken up into three other winds, depending on this coordinate system. So this U, you can break up to this U component just longitudinally, that means front or back. And then it can also be broken up into V, positive V, negative V, and also positive W, negative W. So instead of just having one, you could have U, V, and W. Now, when you study turbulence, turbulence occurs in all directions. So there's turbulence in the longitudinal direction, that means front back. There's turbulence in the lateral direction, that means left right. And there's turbulence in the vertical direction, up down. So you, from this one U, break up into three components. So here, you have three for one U, there's the U, there's a V, there's a W. Notice that this is at a certain value, like say 1 meter per second, This is the average is 0 meter per second. This is 0 meter per second. So the U fluctuates on a certain mean value, but then the V fluctuates around zero. And the W also fluctuates around zero. And if you add up all of this, the average will be the U bar. Okay? So now, what it says here, the U component of the mean wind U. Now this one, it depends on which book or which paper you're reading. The common variable, common symbol to use for mean wind is U bar. Okay, but sometimes you also see capital U, and sometimes you also see capital V. But the one I'm used to is U bar. So here it uses U1 or something. So might be different. So you need to separate this U bar from U. So this U is the component. This U bar is the mean wind. Okay, here it says the U component of the mean U, that means this component of the mean U, is based on an average over a time period, say half an hour, is thus. So if this is the component, then you have one value, when all these values, you average it, divide by the number of values, then you get the average U. That equation there. Same goes for this one. You average V over N. This one, average W over N. And the common averaging time. Okay, how much do you average? You average over a year, over 1 month, over 1 hour. So the common averaging time used is half hour. Of course, some people, last time in the beginning when they were still working on this method, some of them suggested 1 hour, some of them suggested 15 minutes, some of them suggested 10 minutes. But over time, everybody starts to use only one averaging time, half hour, to quantify this. It's because of some, there is some statistical proof. It says that you use an ogive analysis to determine when is actually a stable time to use the averaging time. But that is very subjective too. But I'm not going to go into that now. Just know that the half hour is a common averaging time use. So in the atmosphere, this mean value can change from one half hour period to the next, resulting in a slow variation of the mean component with time. Now, why is this important, this average here? You want to calculate the turbulence, right? So turbulence is a value from this mean. So, okay, going back to this, you know this point here? Okay, that said the average is this. This point here is above the average, right? So this point, let's say I name it as U1. Then I minus the U average. Then I get the U prime. So this is turbulence. Then you go to this point here. Let's say the next point, I just choose this one. So this point, again, let's say this is U10. U10 minus U average, you get U10 prime. So you do that for every, that means for every point. So that means you calculate the mean first. After you finish calculating the mean, then each point minus the mean. Then once you have a lot of this U prime values, say U prime 1, U prime 2, U prime 3, prime 3. You have all these list of values. Then all of this, you average it also. And this value is turbulence. So basically, turbulence is just deviation of the difference between that value and from the mean. And that is what it means by this. So subtracting the mean from the instantaneous. Instantaneous means each point component gives just the fluctuating portion of the flow indicated with a prime, which varies rapidly with time. And then you do that for the other components. You can do that for U, V, W. You can also do that for temperature. You can do that for humidity. And you can also do that for concentration. Now, this UVW is turbulence, or the transport of momentum or friction, remember? At the surface, this is how we quantify the friction part. This is, we quantify the transport of heat. Remember, turbulence is, can be equated with transport of something. So this is transport of momentum. This is transport of heat, temperature. This is transport of mass. Mass of water. This is transport of anything else. Carbon dioxide, PM10, anything. So we can do this. So what you need to do to calculate the turbulence is just by having time series of each component, get the average, then each point minus, you average all of that, you get the turbulent component. But the average is of 30 minutes to 1 hour, where 30 minutes is more common than 1 hour.